Welcome to the HMO Success Podcast. I'm your host, Wendy Whitaker-Large, and I'm here to help you create a profitable HMO portfolio. Whether you're a brand new investor or you've been at it for a number of years, my podcast is here to help you make the most from your business, whether that is starting up, scaling, or systemizing. Please hit the subscribe button to make sure you never miss an episode. And if you've got an awe-inspiring project, an inspirational investing story, or a unique approach to HMOs, I'd love to hear from you. Hello, everybody. Great to have you on board. Welcome to the HMO Success Podcast. This is episode 85. And in today's episode, I'm really pleased to have somebody on board who is an expert in a field which we all need. We might not love them, but we certainly need them. It is somebody who knows the mortgage market. And I'm really pleased today to have a very special guest with me who's going to chat through what's happening in the mortgage market and perhaps also give a bit of insight into the conveyancing world, because he's got some very, very interesting insights and news to tell us about conveyancing. So he is what he calls the Metallica of mortgages and slayer of markets.
Slayer of meerkats.
You're also the co-founder of Fix My Legals, and you're the official rabble rouser at Peak Mortgages and Protection, although maybe not for so long anymore, Rhys. But anyway, we'll come on to that. So my guest today is the amazing and the wonderful Rhys Schofield, and he's here today to talk to me about his business, how they started, what they do, how they help people, particularly with HMOs. But what's amazing about their brand and their product offering is that Rhys is based in the Peak District. So a lot of what he does, a lot of what he is about helping people to kind of connect with, you know, the earth. There's a sense in which this is very earthy. It's very real. It's about nature. It's also about how you can be at your peak by working with Peak Mortgages and Protection. They've got a whole host of awards. You've been extremely successful, actually, in getting your various different awards, Rhys, which is very, very impressive. And because of the place that you're based, but also what you're trying to do in the market, you claim that everything you do at Peak is about being the best you possibly can when it comes to what you do. And of course, that's why you have managed to get so many awards over the last 4 years. So you've got lots and lots of experience. You've also got some experience dealing with rubbish conveyancers. And this has, of course, created another opportunity for you guys in terms of your entrepreneurial spirit. You've created something which I'd love to talk to you about today as well. And you're trying to really shake up the industry by making it work faster, making it more efficient, and helping people out there who are just sick to the back teeth of conveyancing taking forever. So, Rhys, a big welcome to you onto the HMO Success Podcast today.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Tell me a little bit about why you started Peak Mortgages and Protection.
Wow. Okay. Well, I've been in the industry for much longer than I care to admit. I have crazy hair, not because I'm particularly cool or anything like that. It is to hide the grays. So I've currently got blue hair today, which is interesting. I started in Lloyds Banking Group. So my route into industry was through Cheltenham and Gloucester many, many moons ago. They don't even exist anymore. I ended up finding my feet there. I ended up training mortgage advisors, left to be a bank manager, did a couple of years there. And then I made the decision to go and be a mortgage broker, working out the back of a corporate estate agency in the worst patch in the worst branch in the region, I should add. My successor, they had an incident where there was a client meeting and a builder fell through the ceiling onto the desk in the middle of a meeting. It was that sort of. I ended up being all right at that. Ended up running the region, the top region in the business for a couple of years. But then, you know, I'd always like to work with other mortgage brokers who were real go-getters, and you got them in for maybe a good couple of years, and then they'd go up and set up on their own, and you learn some really good stuff from them. I thought, yeah, I'm fed up of doing it for everyone else. Why don't I share best practice, not steal ideas, share best practice from all the good bits that I've learned from this great group of individuals, mush it all together into one more unified way of doing things. And the rest is history. We started as a business where the metric that was important was, what were we going to get a 5-star review from the client at the end of it? And if it was something which meant that was going to happen, we'd do it. And we were very big on the fact that we wanted to have great reviews. Got over 500 on the main page now, which is very nice. But I think part of that was because we didn't want to be a mile wide and an inch deep and try to be the best in the country as initially a one-man band and now a 14-person band. It's difficult to do that over a huge area. We wanted to pick a small town in Derbyshire, Belper. I grew up here. Up until a year ago, I was still playing rugby for the rugby club. And we just wanted to be the go-to in our town, which that's now widened into Derbyshire. And obviously, yeah, hot off the press today on the data recording, we've announced that we've been acquired by Mortgage First, who are up in Chesterfield, another Derbyshire firm. I'll still be here for the next at least 3 years is what I've signed my life away for, longer if I want to. But just really excited about being able to grow that business from, where we've taken it already. It was quite funny because the industry press, they do like to sensationalize a little bit, and apparently Mortgage First have acquired their rivals. And me and John were like, hang on a second, I don't think we've ever considered each other rivals. We just met a few awards dues and got on and had a similar outlook on wanting to look after people, treat people the right way, just being good at what we do.
But journalists, that's not a story, is it? That's not a story.
It's absolutely not.
Journalists want to make a story out of it. Yeah, definitely. Well, exactly. It's very exciting. So you've just literally sold the business, but as you say, you're still going to be involved in it. What I'd like to understand then, it's quite an interesting kind of business that you're talking about. To what extent do you source mortgages for HMOs?
Yeah, I'd say majority of our business probably is first-time buyers because we're a young, funky brand. We appeal to people who don't really care if their mortgage advisor is wearing a suit and tie. I don't know if people will see this on video. I'm currently dressed like Cactus Jack, if anyone remembers WWE wrestling from the 1990s. So we've always done that. But actually what you find is you start to get this reputation as knowing what you're talking about. So you get more and more of those more specialist inquiries come through. And 9 times out of 10, our guys are all experienced because where we've recruited well is we've taken a lot of the former corporate mortgage brokers who don't like the being managed by spreadsheets or anything like that. They're experienced in what they do. They just want somewhere where they can be kept busy and get left to doing the job well if they're doing the job well. So those guys will be able to do most of the work. We do also have, however, a specialist bridging and commercial broker in the business, Chris, because there are cases which are a bit more niche and a little bit more complicated. You've got to go to one of the specialist lenders. But actually having Chris in the business is really, really helpful because actually if something is a little bit out of the ordinary or there is an advisor who's maybe not necessarily done too many cases like that before, they can go and pick Chris's brains whilst they do it. And we've found that that's made the process so much slicker. It's saving the advisor doing 2 days worth of research when Chris knows the answer off the back of his, off the back of his hand. And actually we've made the decision today as well that one of our advisors, because Chris is so busy, is actually we're going to get them set up to also be a bridging and commercial specialist to deal with the more HMOE piece, the more short-term finance piece, the interesting properties. It's not too satisfying, but 3-bed new builds. We want fun houses. So yeah.
Interesting. So you've really made your mark. And I think the interesting thing about your business is, as well as the mortgage side, which I know a lot of listeners will be listening to and thinking, yes, I need to find someone who can help me with my HMO mortgage. And of course we'll take your details and add them at the bottom of the podcast. But I think one of the questions would be for people who are maybe looking at your business is the importance of a brand. Because it feels to me that the brand element of what you've built here actually is incredibly valuable. And that's one of the reasons why you've been able to sell, because you've packaged up your business, systemized it, you've got processes in place, but also you've got a really clear brand. You know who your market is, you know who you're trying to target, you know what you do, you know what you don't do. Can you tell us a bit more about how intentional that was, Rhys, or did this kind of just come about?
It was very intentional. I think the third post I put on the company Instagram when we started, and it's just coming up to 4 years ago now, was, yeah, being a unicorn in a field of horses. Or the other analogy that I like to use is be a purple cow. So, you know, if you walk past a field full of cows and they're all black and white cows, you're not going to notice anything. But if you saw a purple one in there, you would probably notice the purple cow.
And that's from the Seth Godin book, isn't it?
I think so, yeah. So it was very clear that we wanted to be able to do that, because if people want a suit and tie type of business, that's absolutely fine. That's out there in abundance. But what we probably find is that there weren't too many firms that were talking to customers in their own tone of voice, in their own language. We've got an industry that is, this is why I'm stepping back from advising and being regulated, because I get in trouble. I hate jargon. I hate the way that the regulator makes us word things sometimes. It's done with the best intentions, I think, to make sure that people understand explain things properly. But I think sometimes people can hide behind that a little bit and bamboozle a client. Tick the box to say they've talked about it, but you ask the client, did they actually understand what was said and what it meant to them? They probably don't know.
I think that's a really valuable point, because I think one of the things when we're running HMOs or managing HMOs is being able to explain to the tenant in their kind of language what the process is. Because as you'll very well appreciate, in the lettings game, there's a huge amount of compliance, just as there is in the mortgage industry, a lot of compliance. And I think it's always quite challenging to be able to make the language that you use the ordinary language of everyday folk when you know, you're being told there are always these kind of phrases, like, for example, right to rent. Well, those of us who are in the industry, we talk about right to rent, we know what that means. But for somebody who's maybe new to letting a property or letting a room, they come along and we say to them, oh, have you got the right to rent? And they might say, what do you mean? Have I got the right to rent? Surely I've got the freedom to rent. What do you mean the right to rent? And what we're referring to is it's a shorthand to the online system that we have to use to check that a tenant has got the right to rent. Now, we can get into the debate about whether we should or shouldn't be doing that. Personally, I don't believe we should, because I don't think we should be working at arm's length for the border patrol. But anyway, immigration is a whole other topic. But I'm sure that there are times when you've also felt that dilemma between staying compliant and using the terminology of the industry versus making your services and your products something that ordinary people can relate to.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's striking a balance. There's things that we have to run through. That's fine. But I think sometimes we spend as much time explaining what they actually meant than if we'd actually just explained what we meant in the first place. There is a lot of jargon out there, and I think there's a lot to wade through. And especially if you're, say, you're a first-time landlord, first-time HMO landlord, you've got all that new mortgage jargon in there as well. You've got a heck of a load of new rental jargon in there. And it's tricky to pick out the bits which are really important, because the human brain can only take so much. And if you talk to clients in mortgage appointments as many times as I have over the last 17 years, you realize that it doesn't matter if you keep adding bits to a meeting. I don't think the clients will necessarily leave with any more stuff. They'll have just forgotten something else different. Keeping it simple. I think the big thing, which was very transformational for our business, believe it or not, was COVID, actually, because I was really old fashioned. I would not do a telephone appointment. I would only talk to a customer if I could see them face to face. And that was so I could show them what was going on the screen. And this is always part of our process. I even used to sit, this is very non-social distancing, but I used to sit in an appointment on the same side of the desk as my client with my screen up. So they felt like they were involved in the process. Mm. And I that seems so weird to so many people, but I'd spend a lot of time managing advisors as well. And what they'll tell you when you're having your training and development on your own coaching skills, don't sit the other side of a table to someone that you're coaching. You create a barrier, so you sit the same side. Anyway, back to my point, COVID made us actually embrace using video, and the fact that all of a sudden everyone just had to learn how to use video conferencing, and it wasn't a big deal anymore, and being able to screen share with a client and not just show them why we're recommending a particular lender, the lender that we're recommending, we're showing them why and how we've got to that point as well, and they feel a lot more involved in the process. We don't get loads of questions these days, which we might have done historically, where, oh, I've seen this building society that no one's ever heard of, and they're top of the Best Buy table. And then they say, oh, yeah, why can't you approach them? You say, well, you have to live within, 1 mile of Kendal in the Lake District to be eligible for that, that sort of thing. And I think because people understand and they maybe feel like we're on their side a little bit more sometimes, maybe than when you've got no relationship whatsoever, that's worked really well for us. And it's meant that we've been able to deal with people, not just in our own town, although 90% of our business does come within, 10 kilometres of the office. I only know that because of Facebook ads. I'm imperial, really. But it's meant that we've been able to pick up little enclaves of people. So we've talked to each other and recommended us to the friends and family. So we've got a load of clients in London, a couple of towns in Surrey. We've got loads of people. Bristol, we've got a bit of an enclave around sort of 30, 40 clients who've talked to each other. So it's been great for us.
Yes.
For the clients as well, because they're still getting that same thing where they can take it all in and see, because so much communication is visual rather than the words or the content or the tone of voice. That is still important, but most people take more information in visually, so being able to give that to people is really helpful.
Now, that's a really good point, because I think that one of the problems sometimes with HMOs is there's a lot of paperwork, there's a lot of written stuff that you have to convey to the tenant, like your AST, you maybe have house rules, you maybe have a welcome pack. These are all good practices. They're often what's necessary in order to run a licensed HMO in particular. But it can be a bit overwhelming for the tenant. And I like your suggestion of making things a bit more visual, finding a way in which you can create documentation or signage even in the property, which the tenant can see and relate to, particularly because we have a lot of tenants who don't speak English as their first language. So they're also navigating a new country, a new language, and some of it, I think, must feel very, very unfamiliar. And it sounds like that's the kind of how you've adapted and changed through COVID to recognise the importance of the visuals in terms of communication. So I think that's absolutely great. Rhys, I want to ask you about the growth of your business, if you don't mind. So you started 4 years ago, and yeah. Was it just you who started the business on your own?
Yeah, just me, in a little office up the road, just a tiny little service office, just so I had a base. A few people who go on the journey now can work from home, because you can work from home very easily now. But back then, like I said, I wanted face to face, and I was too much of a Luddite to do video. just me. And then after 3 or 4 months, brought Liv in, who was my first employee, and she's been worth her absolute weight in gold, because we made this agreement that I deal with everything that's regulated and you deal with everything else. So she's our HR, IT, all this sort of thing. So with the sale, actually, Liv, she's so good at what she does, and in fairness, all the clients know her anyway. She will be our first new employed advisor, so she's taking that leap into the great unknown in the summer. We grew out of necessity, because we were just getting so many inquiries, again, from that word of mouth. That, yes, we run Facebook ads and stuff like that, but we just needed the capacity to deal with the inquiries that were coming through. Like any mortgage brokerage, we probably had 2 years worth of boom times, and then we had a bit of a a bit of a rubbish October, November, when the government tried to just kill the property market and all momentum. But then, yeah, been really, really busy this year.
Sounds like your USP, your unique selling point, which started off really looking at first-time buyers, local people, based, you know, the name, of course, is kind of got that dual meaning, peak in terms of top, in terms of height, but also in terms of where you're located. So you've got a really nice play on words there, I think, in your name. I think that's a really well chosen name. But your USP has obviously served you incredibly well. So would you say for other business owners who are looking to maybe create a niche, that having something of that ilk can serve you? And if so, how does it serve you?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's good to have a niche, because you can't really be all things to all people. It's just not possible. And like I said, it's very important not to spread yourself too thin. And I know, certainly in the mortgage world, some other really successful firms that have done massively well by finding a niche and being the people who talk about it with, in the most engaging way, with the best clarity of voice. So I'm good friends with a chap called David Sharpstone, and he runs a business that just specializes in the constructioning industry, weird pay scheme that they do. So where they're self-employed, but they get a pay slip at the end of the month. So it's contractor statements for construction industry workers. That's his niche. He's the go-to in the industry. He's the go-to when another mortgage broker gets stuck with that sort of case, because we can all do them. But we'll all send David a message, say, right, mate, what's the best lender for this? And he's done phenomenally well out of that. I know another broker, Jamie Thompson, and he's carved out a bit of a niche for stipends. So people who might be doing PhDs and things like that. And actually, once you have a niche down to fine art, and there's not a huge pool of lenders to choose from, you get that sort of inquiry come through, you know, 30 seconds into the conversation where it's going to be the easiest place to place it. And you get so used to just following the process to go through with the lender, that actually those cases then become quite easy. David's going to kill me for saying this, even if he listens, because I asked him, why did he do the construction industry scheme thing? He said it's because he likes using Halifax because their system is the easiest. And at the time, Halifax were about the only lender doing them. He found his niche by accident by being efficient in what he wanted to do. But
that's a really good point, though, because there are these niches in every industry. And I speak about this with regard to HMOs, that if you're going to try and be a rather bland HMO operator, you will get lots and lots of inquiries from lots of people, but they might not all be right for you. And actually, by being more niche in who you are and what you offer to the market, you can determine not only the type of tenants that you have, but the type of tenants who will stay with you. And by having that kind of strength in the marketplace, it also allows those tenants to feel secure, knowing that you only take a certain type of tenant, which is similar to them. So I think it works across all industries, the idea of niching and specializing and being really good at one thing. And I think it's interesting to hear you talk about these. They're probably what might seem to be very small areas of specialism, but I'm sure there are hundreds of thousands of people who are caught out because, let's say, they are, they're on a stipend rather than a salary, and they want to get a mortgage, and they don't know who to go to who understands the process and the system for getting them that mortgage. Great example. I love it. And I think that's what's really exciting about what you've done, Rhys. Obviously, you've helped many, many hundreds of people with their mortgages, investors, housing, individuals, people, you know, first-time buyers, maybe people who are moving up the housing ladder. But it's actually about your business, how you started it and how you scaled it and how you've now sold it. I think for a lot of people listening, they'll be very inspired to know how you've done it and, if you like, the approach that you've taken to make that happen.
Yeah, a lot of hard work and late nights and all that sort of thing. And I think I think it's interesting. I think like I said, the growth kind of had to happen because I've always thought if you have a reputation for being the best at what you do, people are going to come. It's hard work to get to that point. And I guess it was a bit like a runaway train. I think we were priming's everything, as they say. And we were fortunate, I guess, in what had happened in the last couple of years in the housing market anyway, because first lockdown ended and all of a sudden everyone wanted to buy a house.
Well, they weren't paying stamp duty, were they? That fired up the engine of purchasing.
They did, but then I think we just had a good 18 months to 2 years of a house would come on the market on Saturday. They'd have an open house and they'd have 3 or 4 offers on the Monday, all for increasingly over the asking price. And that was good timing that we got to ride the back of that, I'm sure. But then I think it is obviously very hard work to get there. And I think I worked bloody hard.
Yeah, of course you did. That goes without saying. I think to think that you can do this, from 9 to 5, 5 days a week and not have to work any weekends or any evenings. It's ridiculous. Of course, you must have put in huge amounts.
I worked every weekend for the first year. And then I think we got to this really interesting point with the number of advisors that we had and the size of the business that really we needed to, we were at a point where I couldn't do it all myself. We were at the point where maybe we needed an ops director. We certainly needed some additional positions of responsibility who all want paying for. And we probably needed another 2 years of pain to get to probably the promised land where I could be a bit more hands off with it. But your priorities and circumstances changed. I got engaged at Christmas. I'd quite like my fiance to still marry me by the time we...
Congratulations.
Thank you. And we haven't got the wedding yet, but we have got the rings. We picked them up on Sunday. So
great.
Done anything else yet. But you know, I thought I'd always had this sort of initial goal of I want to sell the company for millions and whatever and retire and live up a mountain and have all the money in the world and all that sort of thing. But you can't take it with you. And I thought it's not worth that pain. I can be comfortable. I can do well out of what we've agreed to do, but I get to enjoy the time with the people I want to enjoy the time with.
Well, the other thing is, of course, Rhys, I think it'd be good to move on to the other burgeoning area which you have initiated. And I think this is very exciting because from somebody who has been in property for over 25 years, I've worked with many mortgage brokers, and some of them are unusual and a little bit different. Many of them are very similar. I think we all need a very good mortgage broker. I think that just goes without saying. And finding somebody that you can connect with, you can relate to, amazing. And I'm sure that's exactly who you are and your team are for your clients. But I'd like to move on because I'd like to talk about Fix My Legals. Tell us about Fix My Legals. This is the area that I'm particularly interested in.
Yeah, me too. And this it is probably goes some way to why we took the decision to sell now, is because Fix My Legals is so exciting. So, I mean, anyone, if you ask any of your listeners who bought and sold properties before, what was the worst part of the process? I would imagine the vast majority of them are going to say one thing, and that was the solicitor's legal side of things.
Yes.
Try being a mortgage broker that's dealing sometimes with a couple of hundred of those cases a month, and you name it, we have heard it before. And seeing as we do everyone's progression for them and we'll keep them updated, that gets quite tough for us as well. And I think everyone's frustrated. It got really bad when the market got busy. We always used to say average turnaround times on a house purchase allow about 3 months, and that's about right. It's still not that now. We're still looking 5 to 6 months. We've had times in COVID. I've never known, or not even in COVID. I think it was being used almost as a bit of a smokescreen sometimes, where we were having to extend mortgage offers, and then the extensions were running out. Well, it used to be that we'd only extend a mortgage offer in an absolute emergency, because they're normally valid for 6 months. And if not run through in 6 months, something significantly has gone very wrong. And I think we were just kind of done with it. And as a business that has grown off the back of reputation and reviews and things like that, and actually I look at the other successful businesses that have done really, really well in our sector over COVID, they're trading on the fact that they've got a great reputation and reviews and all this sort of thing. Well, what better way to torpedo your reputation than recommend a rubbish firm? Because it looks bad on you. Estate agents feel exactly the same way as well. And we're all in business, you know, mortgage brokers, estate agents. We're in a business where we've got cash flow to worry about.
Yes, completion matters, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Completion is where you get paid. Completion is where the estate agent gets paid.
Exactly. And it means so much to a client as well, because if you think about, say, a HMO landlord who's selling an empty property or something like that, well, if it takes 6 months to go through, but they've got 6 months of debt repayments on the mortgage to make, we're talking huge financial costs for all considered as well. And I think that there were referral routes out there where you could, if you were a mortgage broker, say, can you do me a legal quote for X, Y, and Z, they'd do it. And we used a couple. But again, the service with them went out the window. And once you scratch the surface a little bit, you realise that, A, they're not paying the conveyancers very much money, so none of the good firms will want to use them anymore. And half of them are owned by the big corporate warehouse firms anyway, who get their work regardless of what the service is like, because they've got the corporate contracts to do all the remortgages for this, that, and the other corporate estate agency, or they're doing the remortgage work for one of the big banks. I found this out the other day. I had a meeting with one of the building societies, did a networking do, and they were saying, oh, yeah, I used to work at one of the big conveyancers. Do you know what our margin was on every single remortgage that we did? Do you want to have a guess? This is a good question, this one.
It is. This was on the remortgage.
On a remortgage, what their margin was on a remortgage.
And this is the conveyancer.
Conveyancer, yeah.
Oh, I'd say maybe 5%.
12 quid was all they made on a remortgage. So you wonder why, when something goes wrong or there is a hump in the road, why they don't drop everything to deal with it, because it costs them an absolute fortune where there is a hump in the road and stuff like that. So that is the state of the play with a big chunk of the conveyancing referral market, and you've got these intermediaries in the middle that are often corporately owned and they just don't have that interest in something which wows your customers.
And yes.
Which,
as you say, it's a complementary, although different, process that is so incredibly important for the people you're working with. So you've got clients who are waiting to, they may have had a decision in principle, they might have all their deposit lined up, they've got the stamp duty ready, everything from their end is ready. The one thing that's holding them up is the legal process. And this is such an important complementary service to what you're offering. I can well imagine how frustrating it would be as a mortgage broker, because you could potentially be losing work, losing business, if you don't have a good conveyancing team, the other side, to help progress that right through to completion.
Yeah. And what we've done is actually very simple, because me and my co-founder, who has to remain nameless at the moment, non-compete clauses and all that sort of thing. We shared the same frustration, but realised that there was a better way of doing this. But when we first started, our initial idea was, oh, well, let's just have the best portal. It'll look really good and all that sort of thing. And then actually it was a chance meeting with our other co-founders who we were fortunate enough to have someone with deep pockets to bankroll getting it up and running and pay for something that was going to lose money for 8 months. They said, hold your horses. It's not your portal that's important. It's actually what's your core premise is that you're doing conveyancing, but you're doing it better. And the basic bits that underpin it are not complicated. It's solicitors never do anything without a deadline. So we've got the stages of a house buying process. We talked to the solicitors and said, right, well, how long should this job actually take? So when something needs doing, we say, okay, well done. This, we're on to the next stage. It should take this long. We'll tell you if it's going to take any longer than that. Guess what? The solicitors love it because they don't get called for an update every day for something that's not due back for a fortnight. There will be nudges that gently go out to them if it's not done within a couple of days of the end. So everything is done, you know, in time, and they're proactive about things. Because I think there's nothing more frustrating than a solicitor that sits on something and doesn't do anything with it for a bit. So we're forcing the proactivity, and we're forcing that it gets communicated to clients. And the updates that get issued are really comprehensive as well, because there's nothing worse than asking a solicitor for an update and they say, oh, we're just waiting for inquiries. Well, what does that mean to a mortgage broker or a client? That solicitor speak for, go away, I haven't got an answer for you. So it's okay, we're waiting for this back. We expect it back by this date. It's not a hard thing to put into the process to actually make it so people feel a bit more in control of their own transaction. And by having those deadlines worked in and expected working days, we're finding that it's going through quicker as well. So our average time to exchange contracts from instruction to exchange contracts is 56 working days, which is about 2 or 3 months faster
than yes.
at the moment.
So how does the actual service work? So let's say I'm somebody who's bought and sold a couple of properties, or maybe bought a couple of properties in the last couple of years, got frustrated. I've got a good solicitor, but they're slow. How could I engage with Fix My Legals, and what do you do?
We just ask. Well, we take some basic information, get a quote put together, but we also want to know a little bit about the transaction. So, what are they looking to do? So we can assign the right firm to that work. So if we know that there's a particular firm that's really good at one thing over another, they will get the work. We can, because most of our work comes through intermediaries, so brokers and estate agents. We do have a lot of those guys will have a relationship with one firm in particular where they really get on with them and they finish each other's sentences. And that will be how they will do it. But if we've got a member of the public walking in off the street, we will ask a little bit about the case and the ins and outs of it to allocate the person who's best for it. So take languages, for example. We now have, I think it's 27 different languages covered off, because not everyone's first language is in English.
Amazing.
So the legal paperwork has to be in English. Having someone on hand who does speak a different, who would speak your own language to actually explain what you're signing is very, very useful. And we shouldn't take for granted that some simple things can make transactions go through faster. I was at a conference a few years ago, and there was some important head of something or other legal chap in the room. And he said they'd done some research, and they found that the best thing that they could do, which they'd done the research and they knew that this would happen, to make every UK house transaction take 1 week less, was as simple as just making sure everyone spells their names right on the initial paperwork.
Wow.
So it's little things that if you could just make sure that they're done up front, do make things a little bit easier. Obviously, you know, we still get snarled up in chains sometimes where you can't control too much if they're using particular firms, and the firms that make us as brokers groan when we hear that they're dealing with a transaction somewhere in a chain. Don't get me wrong, good conveyancers also groan when they see certain names come up when the initial paperwork comes through. But, you know, we're finding sometimes we're getting cases come back. It depends on the local authority and how quick the searches come back. But we're getting cases ready to exchange in a fortnight sometimes. We've just been waiting on everyone else. And the other thing is because we are more generous with what we pay the conveyancers for doing the work as well, a lot of those guys who turned their nose up at panel work because it just was not feasible for them to do the work for that little reward, have come back and are, you know, join the work. And we've got some guys who take panel work from other panels who are now turning off the other panel work because they want more Fix My Legal work, because they know they earn a bit more per case. We've not been very greedy, but then, you know, we're not the cheapest, but we're certainly not the most expensive either.
I think that if you are able to speed up somebody's conveyancing, I think that there's a direct correlation, as you say, between time and money. And the fact is that if somebody's got a house sitting empty for 6 months that they're paying a mortgage on because they're waiting for the completion to take place, that's a huge amount of money. That's a huge amount of risk for somebody. And exactly. Equally with bridging finance, you know, it can take an awfully long time to turn around a remortgage. Well, all the while you thought you were maybe going to be on bridging finance for 6 months, you end up being on it for 9 months. Very yeah. expensive finance. So I think speeding up the process is, you know, amazing. I think it's a fantastic idea, very innovative. And I think that I'm not surprised that you've got such great reviews and you know, I think the business is just going to grow and grow and grow, Rhys.
Thank you.
Let me ask you about AI. So of the areas which I've often wondered about how they could actually impact conveyancing are AI and also the blockchain. Because clearly using something like blockchain would allow conveyancers to share data, share information very, very, very quickly, to compile the information that they needed and to very, very quickly progress a case. What are your thoughts about that? Have you read much about it? Do you have any views about it?
I'm an actual nerd, so I have read a few things about this. I find it quite interesting. I think AI is great. I have used it for a few LinkedIn posts where you ask ChatGPT to write you a funny poem about mortgages, and it's better than I am at these sorts of things. And I think it'd be quite interesting because there's certainly some heavy lifting that could be done by AI where there's pretty straight standard answers. And you could automate some of that stuff that's quick and easy. Yes, you probably need a human being to check it over, A, to make sure it's right, B, to make sure there's someone to sue when it goes wrong. So I think AI will do a lot of those bits and pieces, and I think we'll see more of it. I think we'll see more of it in the mortgage world as well. I think the bit that which we can never get rid of is you still need people to go be involved, because what happens when it goes wrong? What happens when there's a down valuation? What happens when you need to renegotiate the price, when you have to convince an underwriter that something's a good idea? I think there's still going to be need for a human being on there. On the subject of blockchain, I think blockchain's a really good idea, especially when it comes to the conveyancing side of things, because, you know, we've got such an antiquated conveyancing process in this country where it's still rooted in a process that's hundreds of years old. It's just that they might send a bit more stuff electronically now than they used to 30 years ago. But even then, you're still waiting a million years for the land registry to actually do anything. I think having a way to day one, you memorandum of sale has come out, there's some standard documents that everyone's going to need to perhaps see that might be available. Having the functionality to put them in a secure place where all parties could pop in and look at the documentation they need, could, you know, that's not going to do anything other than speed up processes. And I think it also creates a bit of a need for accountability as well. So if your side has uploaded their documents on there, but the other side hasn't, well, why haven't they then? And then you don't get people whinging at actually you when it's, you know, when it's something your own solicitor has not done yet. And I think that would be, I think that would be something I'd definitely like to see a bit more of. Whether it comes round, because the legal professionals seem to be very slow in ever actually changing anything, and their answer to most questions is probably more paperwork, which I also don't think solves the issue. I think it's ripe for reform. You look at how slow our property transactions are in this country versus the rest of the world as well, where, you know, I was talking to a Polish client the other day, and they said house purchases in Poland go through in about a week. Well, why do ours take so long? It shouldn't need to. There's an awful lot that could be done to make that process better. Because even though Fix My Legal is great at what we do, and we got reviews and all that sort of thing, I still think the process is rubbish and takes too long. But
you're layering upon the very traditional, rather antiquated process, a modern way of pushing it forward and helping those involved to deliver faster for the client. But ultimately, you're still underneath it all, the foundation is exactly the same as it has been for, as you say, many, many hundreds of years. Yeah. And it feels to me, that, as you said, that this is something which needs to change. And we're very, very stuck in this country in not being able to deliver fast when there are some complicated legal nuggets that need to be worked through. But I still do feel that programmed correctly, I think a lot of this could be done by AI or, faster system, because I would imagine, and correct me if I'm wrong, that the majority of transactions are fairly straightforward. In the exception where you need a human being with specialist knowledge and understanding to be able to push it through, fine. But what about, let me ask you, what percentage of transactions would you say are fairly straightforward and actually don't need a specialist solicitor to be able to push it forward? Because frankly, an administrator could probably do it.
I'd say the vast majority are relatively straightforward, if dealt with by the right person. I think a huge challenge in the industry is, because the margins are so wafer thin for the volume outfits, they don't pay the staff very well. And a lot of people end up leaving. And if you look at the reviews of some of these big guys, you have clients who are on their third or fourth person dealing with their case since they left, and there's just no continuity. And what you've got is a conveyancing assistant, and then all the work is checked off by a legal partner. But AI could probably do most of the work pretty accurately for those conveyancing assistants. And I think that would definitely speed things up. I think the challenge is when the industry is more or less self-regulated, they're not going to do it themselves, because I think it would mean they wouldn't need to employ so many people in the industry, and they're unlikely to vote for Christmas. I think it possibly stems down to the fact, and those of you who've seen the stuff I put out in the press, is I'm quite passionate about the fact that I would like the government, whichever side of the political divide they are on, I would like them to take housing seriously, because I don't think they do. Because I think we're on how many housing ministers in the last 13 years?
Something like
728. Yeah, something like that. But then it's something which is so fundamentally core to most of the population is housing. You look at what happened to the housing market when COVID happened and people were at home, and the amount of people spending on home improvements, things like that. Housing is so important. And it's one of those things where no one really seems to want to take it too seriously to upset the apple cart a little bit. And all we do is tinkering around the edges, things like Help to Buy and what have you. Great. OK, they've got people on the ladder. People might think that as a business that works with a lot of first time buyers that I like giving landlords a kicking, which will be very popular with some of our clients. But I absolutely fight the line that's the wrong thing to do, because we've got all these legislation changes coming through. There's a lot of stuff which is coming, realistically, we see it. It's driving landlords from the market sometimes, or making it attractive proposition to get in. But what happens if there's less buy-to-lets and there's less landlords in the market to your rent? It's going to go up. We're tinkering around the edges. We don't have enough houses. That's the actual problem. We don't have enough houses. The process is rubbish. That's what we should be. We should probably do. We've gone on off a political tangent here, but it's all. I'm quite pragmatic. I like to problem solve, and I get really cross when people do something which is just tinkering around the edges. If it's broken and it doesn't work, I'd probably rather tear it down and start again. I think we'll get there kicking and screaming. I would like there to be a housing minister that stayed for more than a couple of years and actually tackled the very real issues, because I think you could transform people's lives. If you were the housing minister that could take credit for making buying a house less horrible, that would certainly be popular with me anyway.
Definitely. Yeah. Well, I think that's an excellent point to end on. I the idea of making buying a house less horrible, it's not exactly a catchy phrase or a tagline, but I do see the point behind it. And I think actually what you're doing here, Rhys, which you've done with your very first business, which I know you're still going to be working in a slightly different guise from now on, but in Fix My Legals, I love what you're doing. I think it's disruptive to the industry, which I think is amazing. And I wish you all the very, very best in growing that business. And I would love to share those details on the podcast notes, because I know there's going to be lots of people who will be listening thinking, I need that service. The last two or the last three or however many conveyances I've been involved in, I've literally gone grey overnight. And I now want something that's going to help me to keep on track and know that this system is keeping my solicitor on track so that I'm in the loop at all times. And I think it sounds very exciting. And I think with the birth of new technologies as well, let's see where it goes. It sounds like you've got a great team behind you doing this. And I think it's very exciting.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
You're very welcome, Rhys. Thank you so much for being on today. It's been an absolute pleasure to interview you. And please stay in touch and let us know how things grow and develop. And maybe another year or two, we'll have you on again. And probably by then, things will have developed even further. It'll be very exciting to see. Thank you for listening to the HMO Success Podcast. If you'd like to know more about how you can create a profitable HMO business, please visit our website, hmosuccess.co.uk, to find out more. We have plenty of free tools and information for you there, and also on our Facebook group, The Ultimate HMO Success System. We look forward to connecting with you very soon. Thanks for listening.